Hello everyone. So last class we had seen about X-ray photoelectron spectroscopy. We had also thought about what are those auger electrons that we need to learn. So X-rays and auger electrons. When the core electron leaves a vacancy, an electron of higher energy electron will move down to occupy the vacancy while releasing energy by photons, auger electrons. Each auger electron carries a characteristic energy that can be measured. Now this can be understood by this particular video. See, as an electron gun is moving, it will first move into a system of the atom orbital through which it will try to release the electron. An higher electron will occupy this vacancy and further the next electron will be released out. In turn, we can get the auger spectra. So let us see once again, electron has been moved, it moves to their orbital, and higher electron will occupy that vacancy and auger electron will be released. Now this auger electron, it will give me the spectra. This is how auger electron spectroscopy works. So let us see it once again. Electron gun, it gives some electrons, the electrons move into the core and the higher electron will occupy the vacancy, then auger electrons will be released. Later these auger electrons will give me the spectra. So that is what we saw in an auger electron. So how can we produce the auger electrons? X-ray source can irradiate and remove the electrons from the core level, causing the electron to leave the atom. So this is what we do in our XPS also. A higher level electron will occupy the vacancy. Once the vacancy gets created over there, then the higher level electron will occupy the vacancy. The energy released is given to a third higher level electron. This is the auger electron that leaves the atom. The axial gun can irradiate and remove the core electrons by collision. Once the core vacancy is treated, the auger electron process occurs the same way. So what happens here is, there is an axial electron gun which will shoot the electrons to the core level. Now this is an atomic orbital where the electron gun is shooting the electrons to the core. Now this electron gets released, that is my 2. Once this electron gets released, there is a vacancy that gets created. Now, electron of high energy will come and occupy this particular vacancy. Once this electron occupies this particular vacancy over here, there is some release of energy. This energy will be captured by the next electron and these electrons will be released out. Now this electron that gets released out is called as auger electron, which is going to give me the spectra. So what happens is, electron gun will give electrons to the core level, the electron gets released. Next, electron of higher energy will come and occupy this vacant position and some energy will be released. This energy is picked up by the next electron and the electron is ejected out. Now this particular ejected electron is called as auger electron. Now this is auger electron spectroscopy on a surfacial level and an inner surface. Now electron beam from an electron gun is falling on both the outer level and the inner surface. The electrons will be getting released from both the layers of inner layers as well as an outer layers of an atom. These electrons which are released, they can be analyzed by cylindrical mirror analyzers. The electrons ejected will pass through a device. Now this device is called as analyzer device. The CMA has got two concentric metal cylinders at different voltages. Now this will have, because it is called cylindric, then it will have two concentric metal cylinders at different voltages. One of the metal cylinders will have a positive voltage and other will have a zero voltage. This will create an electric field between the two cylinders. Now there will be some electric field which will be created between these two cylinders. the voltages on the CMA for X-ray photoelectron spectroscopy and auger electrons are different. There the CMA that is used is just the electrons that gets released. Now this is for the auger electrons, that the secondary electrons that are getting released. When the electron pass through the metal cylinders, they will collide with one of the cylinders, or they will just pass through. Now, which one will collide and which one will pass through is decided by, if the electron's velocity is too high, it will collide with the outer cylinder. If it is going very slow, if the electron's velocity is very slow, then it will collide with the inner cylinder. Only the electrons with the right velocity will go through the cylinders to reach the detector. Only the electrons which will reach the detector, that will give me the spectra. With the change in the cylinder voltage, the acceptable kinetic energy will change, and then we can account how many electrons that have kinetic energy to reach the detector. Now, this is how the cylindrical Miller analyzer works. There is an outer cylinder, there is an inner cylinder. There are two voltages. One is zero, one is positive. The other one is zero over here, there is positive. Now, once the X-ray source falls on the sample holder, there will be many electrons which will be released out. Now, auger electrons will be released. Electrons with a higher velocity will go and hit the outer cylinder, and lower velocity will hit the inner cylinder. Only the electrons with the right velocity will move through these cylinders, and then they will go through the slits so that they will have the proper velocity and kinetic energy, and then they will go and reach the detector. Only the right velocity electrons will go and reach the detector, and then only we get the spectra. This is how the cylindrical mirror analyzer works. Now, why do we do this? We already know that we are trying to understand the binding energy of the particular electron in an orbital. So this is the equation that we have seen earlier also. Kinetic energy is equal to h nu minus binding energy minus phi. Kinetic energy, Ke, is the kinetic energy measured in the XPS spectrophotometer. Where do we get this kinetic energy? In the XPS spectrometer. The h nu is photon energy from the X-ray source. Now, how much energy we have given through the X-ray, it is already controlled by us. Phi is nothing but the spectrometer work function. It is a few electron volt. It gets more complicated because the materials in the instrument will affect it. It is again found by the calibration. Different materials will have different work function. Now, binding energy is what we want to know. It is unknown variable. That means binding energy we want to understand. Kinetic energy is equal to h nu minus binding energy minus phi. This equation will calculate the energy needed to get an electron out of the surface of the solid. Once we understand how much binding energy is there, we can understand how much amount of energy should be given so that the electron is kicked out. Knowing kinetic energy, h nu and phi, the binding energy can be calculated. Now, kinetic energy versus the binding energy. Kinetic energy can be plotted dependent on the binding energy. Each peak represents the amount of the electrons at certain energy that is characteristic of some element. Now, this is the characteristic of some element. So, binding energy, it increases from right to left, whereas kinetic energy increases from left to right. Now, as I go on increasing the kinetic energy from right to left, the kinetic energy will go on increasing. The binding energy will go on increasing from right to left. Now, the outer electrons will have lesser binding energy and the inner electrons will have higher binding energy. The basics of this particular graph is the outer electrons can be ejected out easily, whereas the core electrons require more energy to be removed from that particular system. Now, for the same system, the kinetic energy increases from left to right. That means once the kinetic energy is released, the kinetic energy of the core electrons will be higher and the kinetic energy of the outer electrons will be lower. So this is how binding energy and kinetic energy can be associated with each other. Now, how can we interpret the XPS spectrum? The X-ray will hit the electrons in the bulk, that is inner electron layers of the sample, that we already know. Electrons will colloid with the other electrons from the top layers, decreasing its energy to contribute to the noise at the lower kinetic energy than the peak. Now, we have already seen the electrons may not just be ejected out, but they can come and colloid with the other electrons also, and further this will decrease the kinetic energy. This decrease in the kinetic energy contributes to the noise. The background noise increases with the binding energy because the sum of all the noise is taken from the beginning of the analysis. Now, once there is more collisions, that means there will be more amount of the noise that has to be calculated. Now, further we can see that binding energy for the calculation is N1 plus N2 plus N3 plus N4. That means in totality along with the noise, we have to calculate or interpret the XPS spectrum. What is an XPS spectrum? Now, XPS peaks are sharp. In an XPS graph, it is possible to see Auger electron peaks also. Not only XPS peaks, we can also observe Auger electron peaks also. The Auger peaks are usually wider peaks in a XPM spectrum. XPS peaks are sharp peaks, whereas Auger peaks are always wider peak. Now, let us see an example of an aluminium foil over here. Now, observe that here we are making use of a magnesium as a source. That is X-ray source, the work function being 4 electron volt. Now, this we are trying to do on an aluminium surface. Now, what we are trying to do is the 1s electron of the system that we are trying to understand. Now, look at these sharp peaks. Now, these sharp peaks, they represent the XPS spectrum and they represent the binding energy required to remove the electron. Whereas these broader peaks, they are called as Auger electrons which are getting ejected. So can we not see the observation that the XPS spectrum will always have a sharper peaks and an Auger spectrum will have a broader peak associated with the system. Now, if I just want to understand an Auger spectrum, I can understand the Auger spectrum based on the kinetic energy. Now, Auger spectrum graphs are always such broader graphs. Now, these are the characteristics of Auger graphs. The graph goes up as the kinetic energy increases. I go on increasing the kinetic energy, they will be go on increase in the kinetic energy and the Auger graphs can be observed. Whereas here what I am doing is I am trying to understand the binding energy in the XPS spectrum. Now, how do I identify an XPS peak? The plot has a characteristic peaks for each element found in the surface of the sample. Now, there are already tables which are provided with the kinetic energy and binding energy. What we need to do is whatever spectra we get, we just have to compare it to the library of the compounds. After the spectrum is plotted, we can look for the designated value of the peak energy from the graph and find the element present on the surface. Now, already there are kinetic energy and binding energy graphs which are present in the library. So, for an unknown source, we have to just obtain the spectra and compare the spectra with the library. Once there is a comparison of these two spectras, we can assign which is the element that is present. Now, for example, with this particular spectrum, I can easily say that I can compare this spectrum to the library which is already provided to me, and I can say that aluminium is the unknown source that is given. This is not only through an XPS spectrum. I can also compare the Auger spectrum in the library and I can easily assign that yes, it is an aluminium which is given to me as an unknown source system or an unknown sample system. Now, X-rays versus electron beam. Now, we have to understand that there are two sources that we were understanding. One was X-rays and the other one was electron beam. What is the difference between these two? X-rays, they hit all the sample area simultaneously, permitting the data acquisition that will give an idea of average composition of the whole surface. Now, X-rays will give me a composition of the whole surface. Whereas in the electron beam, it can be focused on a particular area of the sample, to determine the composition of selected areas of the sample surface. That is, if I want to do some selected area of an unknown sample, then I can make use of an electron beam. Whereas X-rays can be hit on all the surface and we try to get the complete data acquisition. So electron beam is more specific area, whereas X-rays is more larger area data that we can acquire. Now, XPS technology. XPS technology is considered as non-destructive because it produces soft X-rays to induce the photoelectron emission from the sample surface. It provides the information about surface layers or thin film structures. Now, we try to understand what is the binding energy, how is the structure, or we try to understand what is the unknown sample given to us by comparing to the libraries that are provided to us. So what is the application of this particular XPS technology? We can understand polymer surfaces, catalyst, how they are working, corrosion, adhesion, semiconductors, dielectric materials, electronics packaging, magnetic media, thin film coatings. All these are specific kind of application to X-ray photoelectron spectroscopy. These are the references that I have gone through for doing this particular PPT. Thank you.